Well, good afternoon. My name is Ty Tessitore. I'm a member of the newly renamed Department of Politics and International Affairs and co-director of the Tocqueville program here at Furman. Before introducing the speaker, which is my main task, I want to say a couple of words about the Tocqueville program itself. The program exists to encourage serious and open discussion and dialogue about moral and philosophic issues, which are always embedded in politics. And we invite students in the program to dig a little deeper and examine enduring problems that often underlie many of our most immediate and pressing concerns. To this end, the Tocqueville program sponsors a number of courses and several activities which emanate from the study of the history of political philosophy. Every year, we offer a lecture series linked to a course focusing on questions of contemporary concern. And since there was and continues to be a good deal of concern around the presidential election this year, our general theme for the year is Tocqueville and the American Republic, which provides a unique and often helpful perspective on many of the matters that we are going through and trying to sort out today. The Tocqueville program also offers a wide series of courses designed to introduce students to the background and history of political thought. The third element of the program is the Tocqueville Fellows. This is a select group of students chosen by competitive application who are interested in focusing their studies on political philosophy. And finally, we work closely with the Political Thought Club, an independent student group that meets every Friday. You're all welcome to come. They read a series of great works in literature and philosophy and discuss them for an hour, and it's always a lot of fun. If you're interested in any of these activities or pursuing them, there should be materials outside at the reception at the end of the lecture, which you can look at. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that the Tocqueville program is supported by a broad coalition of philanthropic organizations and generous individual donors, including our founding donors, Ginny and Sandy McNeil, who are with us this afternoon, Beth and Robinelle Curry, the AWC Family Foundation, and the family of Jane Gage Hipp. Our sponsors support the program in the belief that genuine liberal education helps students to become more wise and prudent citizens and more dignified human beings. And we are immensely grateful for this support. Before introducing the speaker, I'd just ask everyone to turn off your cell phones, if you have cell phones with you that are on, or any other electronic device that could be distracting. This would be a good time to do it. I did it just before I came, so I'm okay. It's a pleasure for me to welcome Professor Joshua Mitchell to Furman. Although our paths have only occasionally crossed, I think in part because he spends a lot of the time in the Middle East, I've learned a lot from him over the years, especially about Alexis de Tocqueville through his substantial body of written work. Joshua Mitchell is professor of political theory at Georgetown University, although as I've just implied, he's not always there. He has served as chairman of the government department there, but was also the associate dean of faculty affairs at Georgetown's School for Foreign Service in Qatar, and I think a founding member of that program, right? Yeah. During 2008 through 2010, Dr. Mitchell took leave from Georgetown to serve as acting chancellor of the American University in Iraq, Soleimani. Dr. Mitchell's primary research interest lies in the relationship between political thought and theology as the two interact in the West. He's published numerous articles and books, and I'll just mention his books, Not by Reason Alone, Religion, History, and the Identity of Early Modern Thought, published by Chicago in 93, The Fragility of Freedom, Tocqueville on Religion, Democracy, and the American Future, also Chicago, 1995, Plato's Fable on the Mortal Condition in Shadowy Times, published by Princeton University Press in 2006, and most recently, Tocqueville in Arabia, Dilemmas in a Democratic Age. And he draws in that book, which I'm currently reading, I'll put in a commercial, from his experience in Buenos Aires, in the Middle East, and in America, in Washington, D.C., and Georgetown, how different and students in different cultures react to the teaching of Tocqueville. It's a fascinating read. I recommend it. In addition to writing and teaching at Georgetown and other places, Dr. Mitchell is an avid conservationist working to restore his small forest in the Eastern Shore and helping to develop the next generation of solar panel-powered sailboats. He also, I learned at lunch today, belongs to a local group drawn from a variety of black and white churches who are interested in exploring ways in which the ongoing legacy of slavery can be healed. They meet in the town of Cambridge on the eastern shore of Maryland, which provided a major port for the slave trade until it ended legally in 1807, but de facto only in 1865 after the Civil War. I mention it because, like much in Professor Mitchell's life, his involvement in this local initiative is a lesson that he learned from Tocqueville. Dr. Mitchell will be speaking to us tonight on why the state grows ever stronger. In fact, he's going to explain that to us. And I'm sure we're in for a treat. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Joshua Mitchell.
Good afternoon, good evening, everybody. Let me get this situated. While I'm getting this situated, I'll tell you a story. Like so many of us in political theory, after I got my PhD, I didn't have a job. And so I spent that following year in Chicago teaching in the Common Core at University of Chicago. And I had read snippets of Tocqueville for a number of years before that, but never comprehensively. And I sat there in Regenstein Library and read the author's introduction, which is 11 pages long. And I closed the book and I said, you'll spend the rest of your life with this book. And that has been the case. And there's lots of conversations these days about liberal arts education. I was involved in a conversations last debate at Georgetown a couple weeks ago. And I looked at the students and I said, if you do not walk out of here, as in Georgetown or your college, with 10 to 20 books that you love, then you have spent a fortune and you have no treasure to show for it. And I really do believe you need to find the 10 to 20 books that you love, and then you'll see that your education has been worthwhile. So I'm going to do a number of things in this talk, and I'm happy to talk about Trump at the end if you want. I think it's a very interesting phenomenon, and I've written about this fairly extensively outside of my pure academic work. But what I want to do first is thank you for coming. I know you all have busy schedules, and I'm looking forward to an ongoing conversation about the fate of our country and the fate of liberty in this country. My sense is that we're at a wounded moment in our nation, and that's a difficult thing, but it's also a profound opportunity for people who have been siloed in their own little worlds to recognize that we're not doing very well by doing that. So it's important that people on the right talk to the left, and that's what I'm doing as much as I possibly can. I'm politically an independent, but I think we've got some wonderful things in front of us that we can work through, but we really do have to understand the challenges of the modern age, in particular the challenge of the democratic age, as Tocqueville called it. So that's why I'm talking today about why the state grows stronger. The conventional count among many conservatives is that the state grows stronger because of the influence of German thought. In the late 19th, early 20th century, I mean, if you read Alan Bloom's The Closing of the American Mind, he has whole sections on the importation of German thought into America. And it's a brilliant book. You should all read it. But it's not clear to me that that's fully adequate as an account of why it is the state grows stronger. So that Bloom account and others' accounts even today is that German thought influenced progressivism. And so progressivism is the injury, so to speak, the foreign body that gets implanted into the American system. And what I want to do is suggest that that's not quite so. So I look through Tocqueville's Democracy in America, a book that I've taught pretty much twice every year for 25 years. I've looked for reasons why the state grows stronger. So what I'll do is I'll talk here in detail about seven of them, mention the other 14, so 21 reasons why the state grows stronger in Democracy in America. And then if we've got time after that, we can return to, we can open the floor and have a broader conversation. So, okay. So, can you hear me? Is it still working? Good. Okay. 20th century America can't be understood without reference to progressive ideas, whose implementation shifted the weight of government away from the states and toward the federal apparatus in Washington. These ideas have a historical pedigree traceable to specific authors that first give them express formulation in a book you should all buy. I'm not sure it's the top 20, but Herbert Croly's The Promise of American Life, written in the early 1900s. It's probably in your library. You can get it on Amazon. The growing power of the federal government cannot be understood without reference to progressive ideas, and any effort to oppose them, as I think so many conservatives want to do, with a view to ultimately rebalancing the scales between the federal government and the states, must begin by taking an inventory of all the forces that are very much in play here at the beginning of the 21st century. Progressive ideas offer more than a theory of politics, narrowly understood. They offer a theory of the relationship between state and society, a theory of the human person, a theory of history. Together, they're a comprehensive whole. In biological terms, for those of you who know these terms, progressivism is an organism, a kind of phenotypic expression of a genotype whose code has multiple expressions: a federal government that looms large, a state that increasingly encroaches on the economy and society, a person who is rendered as a material, rational monad without history or durable links to creation or to neighbors nearby, and a view that history itself conspires to obliterate those pockets of darkness that, quote, local life, left to its own devices, purportedly only reinforce. In this talk, then, I want to treat the question, on what basis could the comprehensive phenotype that is progressivism emerge as a living thing? What sort of understandings and self-understandings would need to be in place for the organism of progressivism to grow and even to flourish? One answer is that the sort of person who needs progressive ideas is not really American at all, that he or she has been injected with the poison, say, of 19th century German ideas, so much so that the original American genetic code has been immobilized or destroyed. The antidote on this reading is a genetic reprogramming of the sort that a strict adherence to the Constitution can achieve. What is needed to counteract progressive ideas is a transfusion containing the original material to which the progressive soul is currently allergic. This understanding sets up one of the oppositions between progressives and conservatives that we witness today. The conservative doctor can't seem to get the progressive patient to recognize his illness and come in for help, while the progressive patient protests that the medicine the good conservative doctor has recommended will only make his now healthy constitution ill again. So let's take another course. Let's consider how progressivism might be one possible expression of the American genetic code, so to speak. This is not to say that German ideas weren't an accelerant to the development of progressivism, only that the substrate to which these ideas were bound is homegrown. I'm certainly not the first to explore this idea that progressivism has a more distant genetic origin than 19th century German ideas. What I'd like to do, however, is explore this idea in a new way by asking a single question and using a single guide. The question is, why does the state grow stronger in the democratic age? And the guide is Tocqueville's Democracy in America, that great work written in the 1840s that predates progressivism by at least two generations. Here I'm not claiming that I'm the first to see that Tocqueville anticipated the development of progressivism. What I will do, however, is offer a comprehensive catalog of the reasons why in Democracy in America. Tocqueville thinks the state grows stronger and stronger in the democratic age. This sort of undertaking, I think, has been carried out before. The reasons Tocqueville gives, as you will see, touch upon, or has not been carried out before, touch upon every aspect of the progressive vision and go beyond it as well. A comprehensive account of this sort, I suggest, will be necessary if we are to soberly understand what an effective defense of liberty would have to look like and on what different kinds of terrain the battle is going to have to be fought. To anticipate my conclusion here at the outset, the political battlefield, the one I think people are most concerned about, is but one of many, and by no means the most important one on which the war will have to be waged. Why, then, does the state grow stronger in the democratic age? In Democracy in America, I count some 21 reasons. I suspect there are more, but I know there are 21 in there. Some are so closely associated with one another that we may quibble about whether they are members of the same genus of the same species. The relationship between others is more remote. All of them, in one way or another, returns us to that mysterious center that Tocqueville talks about, the equality of conditions in the democratic age. Some of the consequences he thought could be more easily checked. Others he thought might be insurmountable. That he worried a great deal about the ongoing consolidation of power of the federal government is beyond doubt. Near the end of Democracy in America, Tocqueville hoped that an infantile and servile citizenry, overwatched by a purportedly beneficial in the powerful state, need not be the inevitable fate that awaited our grandchildren. Near the end of his life, there is reason to believe that Tocqueville lost hope. Whether because of infirmaries of old age alone, we cannot know. I will note that your next speaker is Aurelian Criatu. He's coming April 5th, and Aurelian has been doing groundbreaking work looking at Tocqueville's later works I think in the 1840s, 1850s, early 1850s, in which he shows that, in fact, Tocqueville really did lose hope. So I hope he speaks to that issue. So the first five reasons why the state grows stronger fall roughly under the heading of psychological. As I think about it now, of the 21 reasons, one or two are political, why the state grows stronger. The rest are not. So the battle conservatives want to wage against the progressives politically is a very, very small, tiny portion of the reason why we have progressivism today. And I mean by the term psychology something more ample than we normally think. So I'm going to include individualism, the obsession with unity, that's Tocqueville's phrase, restlessness, imagination, and materialism. First, individualism. It's customary to think that individualism counteracts the growth of the state. So, in principle, then, the libertarians among us, would be most strongly opposed to the state. Tocqueville didn't think so. He says, a tyrant will lightly forgive his subjects for not loving him, provided they do not love one another. Right? So if you really want to oppose a tyrant, you have to be able to gather together. If you're lonely and isolated, there's no possible way you can do that. So a tyrant wants individual souls. Tocqueville is a mediational theorist, always thinking about the between. And any of you who know Plato know that this is how Plato positions us too, a different understanding of mediation, but he's a mediational theorist, and I don't want to develop it now, but I think it's because he has Catholic habits of thinking. He himself fell away from faith, but as Peter Lawler, I think, has rightly said, Tocqueville didn't believe in God, but he worried about what God thought of that. Think about that for a minute, okay? So, but he has these habits of thinking mediationally, and so when you think about it then, the state and the lonely, isolated individual, the libertarian, these go hand in hand for Tocqueville. And what Tocqueville's always interested in doing is filling out the intermediary level between the state and the citizen. So as a mediational theorist, he worried that the three-tiered arrangement of society in the democratic or the aristocratic age, consisting of a king and peasants mediated by a landed nobility, would give way to a two-tiered arrangement in the democratic age, consisting of the state on the one hand and lonely, isolated citizens on the other, without anything mediating between them. All that he writes about mediational life and local politics must be seen in light of this worry, for he knew that something had to fill the intermediary space or liberty would be lost. In his words, "I am firmly convinced that one cannot found an aristocracy anew in this world, but I think that associations of plain citizens can compose rich, influential, and powerful bodies," in other words, aristocratic bodies. And so some of you know this, so his answer to the destruction of the aristocratic class was associational life, where people are gathered together voluntarily. That's what fills the mediational space. Without mediating bodies which gather citizens together, individualism will grow and the state will, and so will the state. They are coterminous one with another. Individualism, he wrote, would have a proud public aspect, giving the appearance of freedom and independence. But because each person is weak and on his own, in secret, he will look to the one visible power that remains, namely the state, to care for him. The merely self-interested person, Tocqueville thought, was an untethered person, at one moment proud and independent, the next moment weak and alone. I'm not going to develop this here, but my view is that Tocqueville's theory of the natural condition of human beings is that they're manic depressive or bipolar. And we've made this a medical thing. I'm not going to develop it right here. We've made this a medical thing. Tocqueville thinks it's a sociological thing. And the more we cut the links between persons, the more this natural bipolarity emerges. So it's not a medical problem for him. It's the natural condition. Maybe we can talk about this later. So self-interest rightly understood, as opposed to self-interest sort of nominally and selfishly understood, on the other hand, tethers human beings, brings us together. It's that form of self-interested interest constituted in and through relations to others. In the mediational space of voluntary associations, voluntarily chosen marriages, and face-to-face politics. Social classes of the aristocratic age having been destroyed, democratic man must now voluntarily tether himself to others. And my favorite passage in the book is to be found on page 515 of the J.P. Mayer edition at the bottom. Feelings in a, I don't know what I had for breakfast, but I remember pages from books written hundreds of years ago. It's a problem I have. Feelings and ideas are renewed, the heart enlarged, the mind expanded only by the reciprocal actions of men one upon another. It's always this face-to-face association, which is the key to liberty. Individualism, far from nourishing liberty, isolates citizens one from another and prepares the way for the state to grow stronger. Two, the obsession with unity. Tocqueville invokes this phrase in his discussion of pantheism in the democratic age. And pantheism, of course, is the idea that there isn't a separation between the creator and the created order, which is certainly the basis of Christianity, but rather it collapses the two so that there's no gap, no chasm between the two, so that the world becomes God's body. Some people have argued that environmentalism is pantheism, right? We have to protect the world itself. We don't make a distinction between the created world and the creator. I don't want to develop that, but I simply want to flag this idea that unity becomes an obsession. It shows up theologically, it shows up in other ways too. Its attraction, Tocqueville thought, was due to the emergence of a habit of mind. This is a phrase Tocqueville will often use, certain habits of mind, what I call categories of experience, that he thought particularly pernicious. Democratic man, Tocqueville's phrase, is in his discussion of the American philosophical method, is always in a hurry to get to the heart of the matter so that he may immediately ascertain an idea and put it to practical use. This is the Cliff Notes version of reality, which we're all tempted by, yes? Rather than consider the actual complexity and mystery of the ineluctably plural world before us, we quickly gather disparate things together into systems of thought that purport to comprehend all the particulars without remainder. Democratic man, Tocqueville says, is embarrassed that there should be anything left over, and therefore seeks to be inclusive in all that he does. No, and of course we use this language, but we have to ask the question, where does it come from? Because on Tocqueville's reading, this language would be utterly foreign to the aristocrat who's always thinking in terms of differences. So Tocqueville's argument is this idea of inclusiveness naturally comes into the democratic imagination because we have this consumption with the idea of unity. Nowhere is this habit today more in evidence than how we think about institutions and how they should be internally organized. Not content that different subunits have developed and thrived for reasons internal to themselves, we wish that they all should adhere to one rule. The withering of federal arrangements ensconced in the Constitution is perhaps the most obvious example. But nearly all organizations we inhabit are altered in some ways by this habit. For democratic souls, good reasons have to be given for something to remain exceptional and outside of the rule, the principle, the system. In my home department at Georgetown, we have four subfields: political theory, American government, comparative politics, and international relations. And I have constant arguments with my colleagues who want to say, no, we have to have, in spite of the fact that you have different methods and different orientations, we have to have one set of rules that apply to all the different subfields. How does this emerge? Why are we fascinated with unity? Why are we afraid to have, I'll say it, we're afraid to have real diversity. For all the talk, we're frightened to death in the democratic age of letting real differences remain as they are. And I saw this in the Middle East. I'll explain it later if you want. Everywhere we look, our institutions, to use the euphemisms of the day, have to be streamlined, made more efficient, rationalized, and improved. And with respect to America herself, democratic citizens wonder, why should we have different laws in 50 states when we could have one set of national laws that apply everywhere and to everyone? This is Woodrow Wilson's famous study of the Congress. I mean, this is what he was trying to argue. We need to have, he was one of the first progressive presidents. We had to have uniform rules. Everything had to come out of Washington. Tocqueville's answer, as we know, is that governmental centralization is indeed needed to address certain sorts of problems. This is defense of the realm, et cetera, but not administrative centralization. The business of everyday life, he thought, insofar as possible, should be ordered to the level of the 50 states, each of whose laws are provisional wagers about how liberty should be protected and encouraged. A look at the history of the Supreme Court cases and decisions may reveal the legal moment when the national government stepped beyond the bounds established by the Constitution, if you're an originalist at any rate. Tocqueville, I dare say, would have pointed out that such a legal moment is preceded by a habit of mind obsessed with unity, to use his language. What happens next after the habit of mind invites legal usurpation, we all know too well, expected to perform tasks that are properly undertaken by the 50 states, Congress is soon overwhelmed by the demands it was never set up to consider, pundits declare the legislative branch to be broken, and the executive branch usurps ever more power. Jefferson's letter of March 15, 1789 to Madison declares that the tyranny of the legislative branch would be followed by the tyranny of the executive branch. This is what Tocqueville understood, and he cites the letter. There's another, I'm gonna press more deeply into this, to the sub-political issues or habits of thought that are involved. There's another more subtle but equally dangerous way in which the obsession with unity appears in the democratic age. Namely, the deliberate modification of language, which spares us from the embarrassment and inconveniences that language, always suffused with historical archaisms, reveal. Thus, in the democratic age, we cease to be fathers and mothers. Instead, we become co-parents. Embarrassed by what it excludes, a marriage is no longer between a man and a woman, but rather any committed relationship between loving partners. Here, democratic man jumps scale, so to speak, moves from the species level to the genus level, so that everyone and everything can be included. These are a few examples among many. I'm going to stop right here. I'm not declaring anything about the normative position. I'm always asking the question, I think teachers have to ask the question, how could such a thing become thinkable, right? And what's happened in the gay marriage debate is that you do have to jump scale. You have to talk about marriage as a set of as a committed relationship. So I don't want to make a normative claim. We can have that argument. I'd rather not, but I'm just trying to explain to you how it is that we come to be able to think in these new ways. You have to jump scale linguistically. So this is actually a real problem for liberty. Forgetting, you can take either side you want politically about the gay marriage debate, but this is actually, this problem of genus level language is a very serious problem for liberty, and let me explain why. When the rich species level language of accumulated wisdom is bumped up a level, so to speak, we're left only with an impoverished genus level language that simplifies, includes, sterilizes, and obscures. Through it, all fine points of distinction disappear. Genus level words, Tocqueville writes, are like a box with a false bottom. You may put in it what ideas you please and take them out again unobserved. When our sons and daughters are educated with this sort of language, how can we possibly be interested in or begin to understand Plato, Aristotle, Augustine, Aquinas, Dante, Shakespeare, and Milton? In Brave New World, John Savage has available to him the language of Aristotle, or of Shakespeare rather, to articulate his contempt for the bulletless tyranny of Mustafa Mons. I mean, you know the story, right? And he can gain no purchase of ideas, no leverage with his friends Bernard, Lenina, and Helmholtz, because they've been formed in such a way that these distinctions can't even make sense. And so he weeps, because here's the language that you would need to have in order to understand your experience and to understand liberty, and yet they can't understand it, because they have no reference for it. Language has been sterilized. Dimly aware that they know more than they can see, they're nevertheless powerless to give an account of their servitude, because no terms can be found to name it. In our own day, what sort of defense of liberty can be mounted if a new generation of citizens has been raised, for example, to think that the full range and depth of life can be comprehended by the terms, and we all do this, positive experience and negative experience. I tell my students, do a word search. Do not hand in papers that use the term positive experience and negative experience. Life is so much richer than that, and we have to labor to find a language to be able to explore life in its full depth, and simply reducing it to genus-level language, positive experience and negative experience, is a betrayal of what we're capable of, I think. When the mystery of causation in human life is reduced to impact, to this let's add other genus-level terms like sharing and caring, everybody special, the folks, human needs, fairness, I'm thinking of Rawls, what can be expected, really, if this obsession with unity guides us to find comfort in genus-level terms like these that contain everything but give us little in return? So I think there's a very serious problem with language itself. Another way of indicating, as I've said to you, that the problem of why the state grows stronger is a very, very serious one. Tocqueville writes, every central government worships uniformity, and the language, the genus-level language, gives us uniformity. Uniformity saves at the trouble of inquiring into infinite detail, which would be necessary if the rules were made to suit men, instead of subjecting all men indiscriminately to the same rules. So if you're really interested in saving liberty, we actually have to think about the very language that we use. It's much deeper than a political problem. Next, let me talk about hitherto unfelt wants. This is a passage from Tocqueville. I'm in volume one, part two. Tocqueville is hardly the first one to write about human restlessness. Augustine's well-known declaration, "Our hearts are restless until they rest in thee," in the Confessions, inaugurates a long line of Christian theological reflection on this peculiar problem. Created as he is, problem of human beings, created as they are out of nothing, that moves through Luther, Pascal, Kierkegaard, and whatever else you might say about his project, Heidegger. Man, never quite at home in his world, seems especially ill at ease in the democratic age. In the aristocratic age, society is relatively stable and seems to comport with the eternal order of nature. There, man finds a measure of solace that is no longer available when, in the democratic age, conditions of equality conspire to isolate him from everyone and everything. When the world itself seems to be in communion with eternity, man easily conceives that he is at home, even if only for a while, in an enchanted world. When the world is no longer warmed by the glow of eternity, when it is a place of disenchantment and delinkage, man's agonizing search for a homecoming of his own making commences. Among anti-liberals, this appears under the guise of ending alienation, Marx, or creating meaning in a homeless world, Nietzsche. Among liberals of a certain persuasion, this appears under the guise of making a world wholly hospitable for man, or more recently, saving the world from him. However different, all of these formulations place man at the center, and so interpret his restlessness not as Augustine might have, as an inescapable aspect of being created out of nothing by God, but rather as a prompting to which he must actively respond. Tocqueville's democratic man does just this. Believing himself to be responsible for his own fate, he reads his restlessness as a call to change, or more ambitiously, to transform the world. Tocqueville's suggestion that hitherto unfelt wants of democratic man will be translated into incessant longing for endless government programs. Always looking for an easy way to make his restlessness manageable, democratic mind finds an answer in making the state grow stronger. Now, I'm now just going to go through these each individually and just list them off and just say a couple of things about them. It would take a very long time to go into all the detail, but I'm just going to identify them now, okay? So the imagination is another one that Tocqueville's quite worried about. In the democratic age, the imagination is a big problem, because what happens is that we're lonely and isolated. And rather than getting engaged with other people, our imagination wanders about who they are. The increasing political polarization in the United States, say over the last 20 or 30 years, Tocqueville would say, is a consequence of the imagination being allowed to wander. And by that, he would mean, when we no longer have reason to encounter one another, when we can have our own little isolated worlds, we can build caricatured versions of who the other person is. And so when the imagination is allowed to wander, we have this terrible problem of political polarization, and you have this amplified by the problem of both political parties now being involved in gerrymandering districts so that the people who are elected are capable of committing or convincing people of one particular type of that district that their position is right, but then they go to Congress and they have no reason really nor capacity to deal with other people and to deal with other sorts of issues. So political gerrymandering combined with the imagination of the isolated democratic soul is a very, very serious problem. And so what happens then is when individuals no longer have the ability, because they've lost the practice of dealing with their neighbors who are different, what we do is we look to the powerful state to set up uniform rules, which will purportedly allow us to avoid the frictions of localism. But what this really ends up doing is further enfeebling us, further denying us the possibility of working through the very difficult business of living face to face with people who are really different from you. We become incapable of it, and so the state steps in and has to do more and more and more. This is a vicious cycle, Tocqueville thought. So the imagination is another reason why the state grows stronger. Again, more than just political problems. Materialism, actually, this is a huge, huge issue. Tocqueville thought that it's not only inevitable that the democratic man would fix on the material world, but within measure, it was actually a good thing. Why? So I think, and this is writing an article for Politico right now on the failure of the Democratic Party and what it has to do. So what, and I use this very section from Tocqueville. So Tocqueville sees that there's something very interesting about the democratic age. He says, you have for the first time what he calls middle class anxiety. Now in the aristocratic age, and here he's following Burke, some of you know this, Burke argued that there are two distinct types of humanity in the aristocratic age. There's the gentleman, the upper class, who has leisure time and doesn't have to worry about the material world, who produces high culture. And then you've got the person who's abjectly poor, never can advance in the world because social stratification is fixed, and who dreams of another world. So you have high culture and religious persons. That's what characterizes the medieval ages. That's what characterizes the aristocratic order. But Tocqueville's theory is that as we move toward into the democratic age, all these social stratifications get broken up. And you can follow Tocqueville on this, or you can follow Marx on this. Either way, it happens. That we're still arguing about why it happened, but those social stratifications, those social castes break up. And he says what happens under those circumstances is that you get the emergence of this new type of person, which he calls the middle class. And he does not mean simply an economic designation, which is the way we look at it. What he means by this is a kind of person, think carefully about this, who has tasted enough of the benefits of this world to know of their enjoyment, but is not secure enough in them so that the threat of losing them isn't always on his or her mind. Pretty much everywhere I go, except with respect to the billionaire students of mine in the Middle East, everyone I know, I don't care how much money they have, has this middle class anxiety, okay? And so Tocqueville thought this was the reason why, is a sociological reason why, as you move into the democratic age, we become much more materialist. This is necessary. So you think of this in terms of universities. I went to University of Michigan, grew up in Ann Arbor, land grant colleges. You need to have, as you move into the democratic age, a balance. I told you earlier you need your 12 to 20 treasures, you do. But we're all part of this middle class world, by which I mean a world in which your social standing is never gonna be fixed. And so you're gonna have this middle class anxiety. And that then becomes the delicate balance here. How do you hold on to both these things? So Tocqueville wasn't really opposed to this fact because he thought a middle class, we would have these middle class persons in the democratic age, and it was a good thing. There were some downsides to it, but it was a good thing. He was opposed to it becoming the only way that we'd look at us, at ourselves, as merely material beings. And I don't have a lot of time on this one, but let me just make a distinction. So he writes vociferously against those who want to make us only material beings. Because when you think in those terms, you think of human beings as beings merely with needs. And so you'll talk about the tyranny of need. And Marxism is one way of understanding the tyranny of need, right? What drives history forward is the original problem of scarcity, the tyranny of need. And once you solve the tyranny of need in late capitalism, then human beings can flourish. The liberal position, this is Tocqueville's position, is that human beings aren't simply material beings. They have this aspect to them, but they're also beings who have liberty. And, of course, your use of liberty can go horribly astray. And so the problem for the liberal is not the tyranny of need, but the tyranny of men, as somebody has said. The tyranny of human beings who have free will, who can abuse it. And if you're thinking in terms of the tyranny of need, you're going to be perfectly comfortable moving to a direction not only of national coordination for the purposes of think about the words we use, for the purpose of solving food scarcity, for solving issues of sustainability. You need to think about the terms that we're using here today. Marxism and socialism have been repudiated, but a new tyranny of need language has emerged, and it's largely the claims about sustainability and all this. And don't get me wrong, I'm all for trying to make everybody as healthy and as happy and as stable as we possibly can. But there's a great cost in this, because if you're moving toward the tyranny of, if you're thinking in terms of the tyranny of need, you're not going to be that much concerned about the problem of liberty. And so you're going to concentrate power more and more in a state apparatus, a national governmental apparatus, which claims to be able to coordinate the whole thing. The liberal, on the other hand, is going to say, gosh, isn't it curious that General Electric and Duke Power and any number of other organizations, in the name of solving the problem of climate change, have worked out crony capitalist arrangements with various governmental organizations and national organizations, and maybe even transnational ones, to solve our problem. The liberal is always going to say there's something seriously wrong with allowing corporate power and governmental power to be unified in the name of solving a problem of need. So if you think of human beings as simply addressing the problem of need, and I think we're moving this way, it's not the socialist version, it's the climate change, food sustainability version. If you're thinking in these terms, you're going to pay more attention to the tyranny of need, not the tyranny of men, and so you're going to be very comfortable with the idea of a strong, concentrated, centralized administration that disseminates resources in accordance with the problem or solving the problem of scarcity. You need to think about this. Because as we think of ourselves exclusively as material beings, we're going to move more and more in this direction of having centralized power. So another reason why the state grows strong is because we're thinking of ourselves more and more as material beings. How much time do I have? Okay. Let me talk about envy. So if you read your John Rawls, you're gonna see him make the argument that as we move toward conditions of equality, envy will disappear. Tocqueville reverses this. Tocqueville's view is that when there are huge gaps in society, which can't be bridged, we can't be envious because it's simply unbridgeable. But as we move from the aristocratic age to the democratic age, as social stratifications break down, then nothing is fixed anymore. And under those circumstances, envy grows more and more. And he says in one place, the lesser the differences are, the more we're going to be affronted by them. Now here's the problem. The problem is, as we ourselves become weaker and weaker and weaker, and we're confronted by this envy, there's no other person in particular that can address that. The only entity that can address that is what Tocqueville calls the one visible power that remains, namely the state. So the more and more we move toward equality, the more and more we're going to look to the state to apply laws, pass laws, which insist on more and more inclusivity, right? And Tocqueville's point, I think, is an important one. We're never going to solve the problem, because each time we include more, we're going to recognize more. And it goes on and on and on and on. There's no logical stopping place for it. So envy is one of the reasons why the state grows stronger. I'm just going to mention now, because I'm rapidly running out of time, the collapse of obligation and loyalty. So Tocqueville says that the aristocratic age is characterized by an economy of obligation and loyalty. I could tell you wonderful stories about in Iraq, how there's still this vestige of aristocracy and how I was treated as well, I'm not, I'm a democratic soul like all of us, but treated like a kind of aristocratic figure, and the obligations and loyalty that my bodyguards, for example, showed me. Because I had two AK-47 bodyguards carrying weapons for 2 years while I was in Iraq. But it just this fantastic loyalty that still exists in large swaths of the Middle East. And Tocqueville's point is, as you move from the aristocracy to democracy, that obligation and loyalty gets destroyed, and you only have money left as a way of making society work. And the problem is, money can't do it all. You need to have other things besides that. Now the supplement to this, and this is probably what makes America fantastic, and in comparison to other democracies, is we have a philanthropic spirit. Money can't make everything happen. You've got to have philanthropy. This is why the churches and the synagogues and the mosques are very, very important as a social lubricant. But as that breaks down, and you no longer have this philanthropy, which is the substitute for obligation and loyalty, then the empty places where money can't go to solve problems then have to be filled, so to speak, by state programs. So this is why philanthropy is a necessary bulwark against the growing power of the state. But as we think more and more in terms of our own specific self-interest, it doesn't work out so well. Okay, let me just go through the list. Another one, universal enfranchisement. So one of the characteristics of the move from aristocracy to democracy is the move toward greater and greater enfranchisement. We know this is the case in the United States. It's inevitable because as the logic of equality spreads, we look at exclusions of people who are not allowed to vote. We say, well, that's not fair, the Rawlsian language. And so Tocqueville asks, what happens to the nature of government as you extend the franchise? Well, if you've got an aristocratic nation, aristocratic franchise, you're going to be aiming for glory, so there are going to be some war projects, to be sure. If you've got a middle-class commercial republic that still has a narrow franchise because it's run by the middle class, then what's going to happen is your expenditure is going to be small. But as you extend it to the poor, what you're going to have necessarily is an expanding network of programs that the state is going to have to provide because the poor are now enfranchised, though they don't have the money. This is not I'm not making a value judgment. I'm simply saying the logic of equality, when it's extended to the franchise, means that the state programming costs will go up. Okay, so that's another reason. Place hunting, one of Tocqueville's favorite phrases. So what happens in the democratic age is we have the equality of all. Everybody's competing for everybody, with everybody for every kind of position. And so he says in one wonderful passage toward the end of the book, this leads to a kind of educational system which squanders the imagination of youth and destroys their creativity. This is welcome to college, okay? And so you've got this competition of all against all, and Tocqueville asks, are there manners in which people can avoid this competition of all against all? He says, yes, there's two. One is the military, and the other is what he calls place hunting, meaning the bureaucratic apparatus, permanent employment by the state. So the more and more we've got competition of all against all, people search for escape valves from this. The military is one, and the growth of the bureaucracy is another. So the very conditions of equality lead to the growth of the bureaucratic state because everybody's place hunting. Now, I come to a couple of economic reasons. I'm not going to get through all these, but you just get a sense of what's really going on here. So Tocqueville has a wonderful essay that ought to be read in conjunction with Democracy in America. It's called Essay on Pauperism. It was written, some of you know this, very important essay. It was written before the publication of Volume 1. And one of the fascinating things about Democracy in America, right, Volume 1, 5 years before Volume 2, is that he doesn't say a huge amount about the coming problems with commerce. There is one passage, it's chapter 20 of volume 2, I want to say part 2, in which he talks about the new aristocracy. And it's 3 pages long. And if you go read it, you'll see his distillation of Adam Smith, Rousseau's nascent theory of alienation from the First Discourse, anything that's good in Marx's 1844 philosophical manuscripts before he wrote them. Before Marx wrote them, but he doesn't go full-blown into the problem of commerce, but he does in the Essay on Pauperism. And so his claim is this, and in a way I'm circling back to philanthropy. He says, you know, when you've got a kind of global commerce, you're going to have periodic crises. Now, what should always happen, the default mode always, should be you look to your community, both to help people, I mean your local community, to help people and to be helped by them. That's the default mode. But he understands that as economic relations become much more complex, you're going to have global crises which overrun the capacity of local social organizations to take care of people. And so he says under those circumstances, you're going to need the state to step in. But he says, the worst thing you can possibly do is have a permanent apparatus to address the needs of the poor. And now I come back to the problem of imagination. Because unless the poor, even the term is the wrong term, but let's use it for heuristic purposes, unless the rich and the poor meet each other face to face, they're each going to have deeply distorted views of the other person. And so he thought, occasionally you're going to have these economic crises, the state is going to step in, all these local organizations are going to pull back, or are going to be asked to pull back, and then when the crisis goes away, the proper thing for the state to do is to withdraw and let the local organizations put things back together again. But what happens is they don't, right? And so then what you get is this caricatured version of the understandings of the rich of the poor and vice versa, and people lose the capacity to help one another. And when they lose the capacity to help one another, then the state comes along and says, see, you don't know how to take care of yourselves and one another, and therefore the state has to step in with its programs. Okay, so economic crises are a big problem. I am running out of time. I'm simply going to list them now, okay? The problem of efficiency, economic efficiency, this would destroy localism. Technological complexity, this is a very, very interesting issue. The more technological sophistication you have, the more you're going to have low frequency, high amplitude events, and so you're going to have to have a regulatory apparatus. Technological misapplication, when supplements become substitutes. Here's the crisis of social media. Well, I'm giving a lecture tomorrow called Facebook is Death. And I mean it. I absolutely mean it. The one political cause, I would say, is war. Because whenever you have war, you're going to have to concentrate power in Washington or your state capital. And Tocqueville cites admirably Jefferson and Washington, who knew this and said, we have to stay out of these foreign entanglements. Just list these again. With respect to time, there's short-term thinking is a serious problem. apprenticeship and prudence on the one hand versus democratic method. This is an epistemological issue. And then one which we can perhaps talk about. Now I'm going to do historical ones. Slavery and its after effects. Because of this profound wound of slavery in America, state power had to grow strong. Another historical reason is the enlightenment of nations and the problem of local coarseness. And then there are theological reasons, believe it or not. Tocqueville, he thinks theologically even if he's lost his own commitment to it. The profession to eliminate suffering, the belief that we actually can completely eliminate suffering, which is one of the prejudices of our age. If we have time, I could talk about how Nietzsche responded to this. But that prejudice leads us to believe that we can have the state solve all of our problems. Variant of this is what could be called the perfectibility of human beings. We can perfect people as opposed to recognizing that we can only have amelioration, not problem solving. And then finally, a confused theology, and I will end with this. So Tocqueville has this wonderful appendix. It's called Appendix 1Y. It's an astounding 2 pages in which he says, the great theological error of the modern age is that we have a sterile concept of unity. And the problem there is that he says God is aiming toward unity, but he moves toward that in a world of infinite plurality. And so the theological lesson of this is, if we're proper stewards of creation, we would recognize that we actually have to have real plurality, and any notion of unity, inclusiveness, diversity is always going to be our notion. And it's always going to exclude, even though we're trying desperately, let's be clear, we are trying to include, but it's always going to be limited. So his argument is we have to recognize the fundamental plurality of the world. Another way to put this, and I promise you I will end with this, is the parable of the wheat and the tares. And some of you know this, some of you don't, I'm just going to explain it. So And I'm not going to do the theological equivalent. I'm going to do the democratic equivalent, Tocqueville's reading of the parable of the wheat and the tares. So you know the parable, right? A servant is asked to plant wheat in the field. He plants wheat in the field. He comes back later and says to the master, "Master, there is both wheat and tares, wheat and weeds growing in the field. Shall I pull them up?" And the master says, "No, don't pull them up, lest by pulling out the tares will also dislodge the wheat. Leave them together until the harvest, and they will be separated at the end." Now, in terms of this fascination with unity that Tocqueville is very worried about, this is very important. We want purity. We want to get rid of all sorts of moral debts. We want to have, we want to live with a clean conscience. And what Tocqueville argues is we actually can't. The world is not constituted for us to be able to do that. And if we are able to live with the messy conscience of recognizing that our neighbor's not going to be perfect, that we're not going to have a pure world, then and only then will we recognize that the real site of our life has to be liberty at the everyday level, where we're dealing with our neighbor in all of his or her messiness. And when we start aiming for purity, when we want to get rid of all the evil, it's the state that's going to do it, and we're going to always have a sterilized understanding of unity. I'll stop with that.
So my question kind of involves the idea of unity and the kind of convergence toward more state authority as we try to make laws more unified as a country. And I'm kind of thinking in terms of healthcare and how in the past couple years it's been more toward we're trying to get healthcare for all Americans rather instead of leaving it toward the state level. So is that kind of a result of kind of the system getting more and more complex as time has gone on and the expansion of Medicare and all that stuff? And I don't really know.
All right, well, so a couple things. So one, I think with so many things Tocqueville, the answer cuts both ways. Okay, so one way it cuts is, and you identified it, this fixation on unity. There has to be a national system, right? And Tocqueville would at least ask the question, why does this habit of mind, why is that the default mode? What would be wrong with a system, and you know, some Republicans are arguing that this is the way to go, where you've got state insurance agencies which are competing across state line. So that's one way in which it goes. But the other way, now I'm going to cut the other way, and I mentioned it, is that as technological complexity increases, the costs of getting it wrong become really, really serious, right? And so under those circumstances, it's not clear that you can have a 50-state solution. So where does this leave us? Well, this is so very important, and another person that you would want to read about to get to this problem is Michael Oakeshott, whose brilliant essay, Rationalism and Politics, gets to this. And what Oakeshott argues, and is perfectly consistent with Tocqueville, is that you and I are always looking for principled things to do, right? Decentralize, centralize. And one of the things I hope you've seen in what I'm doing here is I'm trying to say that there are no easy answers. This is Tocqueville's point, in a way, to the conservatives on the right who say, no, we just have a political problem project, let's get rid of the progressives. It's much more complicated than that. And so in the passage which I've cited, feelings and ideas are renewed, the heart enlarged, the mind expanded, only by the reciprocal actions of men one upon another, it would seem like he's endorsing localism. But the passage on technological complexity is two paragraphs above that on page 515. And so that leaves you with not an in-principled resolution, but a recognition that both things are going to be true. We're moving toward concentrations of state power. But what I didn't get to say is Tocqueville thought that while some of this might be inevitable and some of it might be necessary, it's also a disaster for local liberty. And what that means is life is a series of trade-offs. And Oakeshott has this wonderful saying in Rationalism and Politics, if not there, then someplace else in that volume called Rationalism and Politics. Statesmanship is the art of taking the next step. It's the art of taking the next step. It's not we have these conservative principles or we have these progressive principles. The art of statesmanship is the art of taking the next step. And the reason why you take the next step is because you know that there are never-ending trade-offs. Okay? There isn't an answer to the problem. Whenever you hear people talking about finding solutions to problems, you know they've misunderstood the world. Because everything is a series of trade-offs. Tocqueville says, in the aristocratic age, we think of amelioration. In the democratic age, we think of solving problems. So to this problem, it's not that there's an in-principle answer. It's something, some aspects will pull us in this direction, and some aspects will pull us in the other direction. And that's why we need prudential judgment and statesmanship and stateswomanship, however you want to put the term. We need these sorts of things. It can't just be an algorithm. It can't just be a set of principles. And what Tocqueville worries about is we're so looking for parsimony, my favorite word these days, we're so looking for parsimony that we want to have a principled set of arguments either on the left or the right. It's why Tocqueville says at the last page of the author's introduction, this book will not satisfy any particular party, but I have not written it for any particular party. I've written it with a view to seeing the whole of the future. And he sees these never-ending trade-offs.
So in volume 2, part 4, chapter 6, when Tocqueville talks about
what page?
so in our volume, I believe it's 666, when he talks about what types of despotism we have to fear, he paints a really bleak picture of the future, and he talks about a society full of men that are completely isolated, that don't have developed relationships with any other human being. Unless they have children, in a state that's all-powerful, that willingly works for people's happiness, as long as it's the sole arbiter of their happiness. My question to you is how far you think the 21st century democratic man has progressed towards this vision that Tocqueville paints.
So that's actually what I'm going to talk about tomorrow. Let me just give you the several-sentence version of this. So remember what I said at the outset, Tocqueville worries that the three-tiered structure of society in the aristocratic age gives way to a two-tiered structure. And my language is the following. If that's the case, then experience in the democratic age should have a binodal characteristic. Binodal, I mean, we dwell in an experience in two places. Now, if we dwelled in the face-to-face, that would be a third place, but what I'm suggesting, and this is part of what I'm going to say tomorrow again, is that what's happened, that we're there, that what we have is this binodal experience where we have our own soliloquies, which we share with our Facebook friends, okay, our own utterly hermetically sealed world, and then the other node is public opinion, and so we dwell both in our soliloquies, and we can talk about sports games and TV shows and movies. And while they're completely apart, they're united in the following respect. Neither one of them involves risk. Somebody says something to you on Facebook, you defriend them. And of course, there's no real risk in talking about sports. I mean, yes, we can harangue with one another, but there's no real risk in talking about TV shows, movies, and sports, right? So what Tocqueville thought was the real challenge to saving liberty is to have those conversations that involve risk, which always are face-to-face in real time. I mean, what I've noticed in the last 10 years, I'm not the only one, we've moved away from telephone calls to text messaging. This is astounding when you think about it, because a phone call is, oh my goodness, this person's calling, I have to behave and react in real time. Whereas a text message, you can sit on it, wait, respond ironically, yes, you know, something flip. But that's where we are. We're living in this binodal existence, which corresponds to the bifurcation Tocqueville most worried about, right? So I think we're there already, and what Tocqueville thinks we need to do is to get out of this, to risk. And the only place that can happen is not risking going to the polls or saying I'm for Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. That's not risk, no. Real risk is every single day looking out laterally to your neighbor and saying, how can I build a world with my neighbor? And we're not doing that. It's just too hard and too scary. So I suggest we put down the living on glass. We're destroying ourselves by living on glass. You know what I mean by that? Through the tablet and all this. And look out at your neighbor and ask look around you at your local community and say, how can I build a world? Because this is the only world I'm going to ever really know. And if I can come back to manic depression, Tocqueville was very clear on this, that the reason why we oscillate back and forth between mania and despair is because we're not tethered. And the only way we can be really tethered, Tocqueville thought, is through actual friendships and actual dealing with our neighbors. And so the more and more we move to this binodal experience, the more we're going to need drugs and other sorts of soma, to invoke Huxley, right, in order for us to put to sleep the pain. So there has to be risk, but this binodal experience of Facebook and public and TV shows and movies on demand, right, Netflix, whenever you want to see a movie, whenever your taste emerges in this, that way, or another, we can just see what we want to see. This is a serious problem. The only way you save liberty is through face-to-face associations. Feelings and ideas are renewed, the heart enlarged, and the mind expanded only in this face-to-face. It's an astounding observation. And that, don't have time, but that's his answer to all the aristocrats in the 19th century, and this would include Nietzsche, who comes after him, who thought democracy was an accident, that it could never do anything great. And Tocqueville knows he has to answer these critics. And his answer is, finally, that through this face-to-face association, we can build a world with this energy that the aristocratic age has never seen. And so he says, I praise democracy not for what it does, but for what it causes to be done. What it does is always a disaster. What it causes to be done is to draw people out of themselves. And you know this, right? You've been in your own little shell, and then your friend calls you up and says, hey, let's sit down and talk and have a cup of coffee. And you walk away and you think, wow, that's what I needed. Right? That's how we build a world, face to face. And we're moving away from that because it's too hard and we don't have the courage to face the difficulties of real time life.
Going off of that, wouldn't you say that's kind of idealistic considering the prejudice and those types of things exist out there?
I'm idealistic. I didn't hear what you
said. I think it's idealistic to say that how can I build a world with my neighbor? I mean, like, for example, I've lived my entire life in Greenville, but, you know, I've certainly participated in the political process and trying to help others, but being Muslim isn't exactly the most beneficial thing, or is seen negatively in terms of living here. So how do I build a better world?
You just keep going. I mean, my father's family was Lebanese. They came over in the 1890s. It's tough being an immigrant. It just is. And my answer, I mean, look, I can say this because I'm Lebanese, right? And it took my family. I'll say this in the bluntest way that I can, and I really mean it, because the central problem is the legacy of slavery problem. I'm going to insist on this. Do we have time to develop this? Do we have time to go? Okay. So I think this is really important. So one of my latest harangues is against identity politics. And let me explain why. Because identity politics basically says everyone who's not the predominant group, white, generally heterosexual male, has an identity that gets debt points. Sorry, that's how it's working. And I think, I mean, if I had time, I would develop this. There's something in that, because the Democratic Party has understood the problem of fault, and the Republicans have not. I don't want to go in there. I'm just going to state it. But I think it goes horribly astray in the Democratic Party, and I think that's why they lost. So in my view, the issue of fault, transgression, guilt, is one that singularly pertains to the slavery question in America. Identity politics then puts everybody, African Americans, Lebanese, Hispanics, everybody in the same category as receivers of debt points. And I think this is a terrible thing, because my view is if you are an immigrant, I got news for you. It's going to take you three generations, and you're going to get banged up. My father was. I mean, stories of him getting beat up in Worcester, Massachusetts. Every immigrant could tell stories of how when they got here, they got whomped on. And I don't like it, but it's dodgeball. You know the movie? Okay? That's what happens. It's rough. But my view is, as a political matter, the Democratic Party has completely lost sight. It starts with this brilliant understanding that the civil rights era, I grew up in this, you know, with Martin Luther King, and this covenantal language of healing the great wound of slavery. It's a covenantal language. And it gets hijacked by the political left. It moves into identity politics, in which case everybody who's non-white gets points. And my view is, no, it's qualitatively different. The great wound in America is slavery. And every other immigrant, like me, get in line. I mean, I'm really that tough about it. Because I think if we've got limited resources of the federal government, we need to distinguish between the real historical problem in America and the problem that every immigrant group has, which is it takes time. And so my answer to you is just keep going. It might not happen in your generation. You know, my father's generation was the second generation. I know so many, you know, Lebanese, Italian, Americans, they were ripped apart because they know the old country, they're moving to the new country, but they can't quite get there. It's my generation. It's the third generation where you finally say, well, yeah, I got this Lebanese blood in me, but I'm kind of American. It takes a long time. And this desire to have instantaneous acceptance, it's not going to happen. So keep working at it. It's going to take a long time, but the real wound is the racial wound. And that's the one where both at the local level and at the federal level, we have to singularly focus. So I think identity politics is a betrayal of the Martin Luther King language, because that Martin Luther King Day should not be about Hispanics or Lebanese. It should not be. And it has become that because Martin Luther King is seen as fomenting or preparing the way for identity politics, in which case we celebrate all these identities. That's the wrong way to go. So I'm really pushing back. I even push this and say that identity politics is white progressive racism. And I'm going to explain why. And I got this from being in the Middle East. You know, I've got all my colleagues who are teaching them, my Middle Eastern Muslim students and others, identity politics. And my students who come from these vastly, you know, differing backgrounds say, well, that's curious. So I can't just bring my story. I have to translate it and say, I have an identity. What's that all about? So the terms of engagement by which you're allowed to enter into the conversation, the white progressive conversation, is you have to use the language of identity politics. So my Middle Eastern students have to put down their beliefs. The African Americans have to put down their deep religious beliefs and say, I have this identity. I think this is tyranny. So I'm completely against identity politics because it's blind to the central problem in America.
So I don't think Tocqueville is necessarily trying to form a completely comprehensive teleology or anything like that, which you alluded to with the German thinkers that influenced progressives. But at the same time, he does say that the state is moving in a certain direction, and it's moving, in a bad sense, towards possibly the schoolmaster state or the soft despotism that he describes. And I guess my question would be, you know, the title of your speeches, It Grows Ever Stronger, the state grows ever stronger. Does at some point that stop? Does the weight of the state destroy itself? Does it become something other than a democratic state? Or does it just self-perpetually keep growing?
Well, you've got four or five fantastic questions right there. All those clauses, you know, you would have different answers to it. So there's a letter that he writes that haunts me. He said, I sometimes think that in order to establish democratic liberty, we will have to see the full flowering of tyranny so that we know the costs. That frightens me. I don't want that to be the case, but I think that there's something to that. And but what's interesting, Plato and Tocqueville, while both very different, see that the next step after democracy is tyranny. Very interesting. I mean, we want to say, well, think of comparative politics. There's a transition to democracy, implying that democracy is the stable form and all these others are non-stable forms. Incidentally, my Muslim students in the Middle East say, Professor Mitchell, those American students of yours are so silly. They think democracy is the highest political form. We know constitutional monarchy is the highest form. They really believe that. So if you're really serious about being a global pluralist, accept that democracy is not going to be around. It's not going to be the form that everybody wants. But so Tocqueville thought that tyranny is right around the corner, and it's not going to come, this is to the gentleman's question about volume 2, part 4, chapter 6, it's not going to come overtly. It's going to come because we develop these habits of mind that actually allow us to, or will be the conditions under which we give away our freedom, because the labor of this difficult liberty of face-to-face associations is just too much for us. For all our talk about, you know, encounter and difference, and we're scared to death of it. And the only way you get over it is by doing it. But we've constructed a world where we have less and less of that. So he does worry about the inevitability of it, but he's also very clear, because he has a wonderful chapter on historians in the aristocratic age and the democratic age. And he says what's curious about historians in the democratic age, and this is before Marx, but it applies to Marx and to Hegel, right? He writes before Tocqueville, is that they have a kind of necessitarian understanding, right? History is destined to do this. The version we have of this now is the whole recent thing with Brexit and Trump, right? Isn't globalization inevitable? Isn't this just, this is the nature of things? And Tocqueville says this is very curious. An aristocratic historian would never make claims about inevitable historical outcomes. The democratic soul needs inevitability because it's scared to death of an open-ended system. And so he says in the second to last page of the book, he says these are the idea that this is fate is a cowardly and pusillanimous doctrine invented so that men do not take responsibility for the freedom. So God has, this is his language, gave a circle beyond which we cannot go, but within that circle we're free and we can act and should act. So he's never prepared to say it's over. He is prepared to warn us that it's that unless we do something, it's gonna come at us stronger. So if we do nothing, it's an active-passive thing. If we do nothing, it will come. If we do something, we can push it back. And there's never a full resolution. This is why Tocqueville says, and I'll stop with this, he says this whole book has been written under a kind of religious dread, an angst. God has some plan. It's important that we move toward equality, but this could fall into tyranny. And he's worried that the people who emerge in this democratic age are going to blindly accept equality, inclusiveness, all this stuff without understanding that it's real work. It's not just the state's going to do this with rules and various programs. It entails work of citizens every single day if you're serious about liberty. If you just want equality and servitude, which is where he thinks we're going if we do nothing, go for it. And this is, by the way, the movie WALL-E. Okay, the movie WALL-E is very, you should all go back and watch the movie WALL-E, because that's the kinder and gentler despotism at the end of history, where all your needs are taken care of.
Okay. Well, thank you. We're running out of time right now.